to compare our democracy to an internal combustion engine, then this is where the fuel is ignited, forcing the pistons in the form of MPs to thrust into action. Or to put it more reproductively, this is where the sperm of the people meets the egg of the government, giving birth to something we call politics. The men and women who occupy this debating chamber provide us with something far more valuable than just leadership and vision, because they also provide us with endless entertainment. Like the Mile High Club, the Speaker's Chair Club is an exclusive sexual fraternity. Indeed, it's considered a badge of honour for an MP or press gallery flunky to engage in a fornicatory assignation upon what is arguably the very seat of government. The Speaker's Chair Club. Firstly, are you a member?
You'd hear tales that people, after press gallery parties, have gone down and shagged on the Speaker's chair.
It's just wrong. I just don't see how you could get in the mood in such a location. I'd be thinking of Jonathan Hunt all the time, and I don't think that that would be very romantic.
I don't think you can be remotely surprised that young, or maybe not so young, press gallery journalists or parliamentary staffers should from time to time crawl into the Speaker's chair to play hide the sausage.
If only William Larnock had shot his load on that venerable chair rather than shooting himself in the head. Larnock committed the ultimate act of political suicide in 1898, blowing his brains out in Parliament. Thankfully, most of the carnage that takes place in Parliament is of a verbal nature.
MPs on show and at their worst, baiting each other.
What's today, sunshine?
Abusing each other.
For that member who's interjecting, would he like to take his pills?
They're thieves and they're cheats.
The windbag on the other side of the house can shut up for a moment.
No.
I'll answer his question.
And generally letting their tempers get the better of them.
Absolute bullshit.
But the most outstanding example of bad behaviour happened on International Dress Like a Pirate Day in the year 2000, when Alliance MP Grant Gillan asked this question during a debate on genetic modification.
I'll ask the Minister whether, no pun intended, Mr Speaker, whether it's appropriate in this case for a woman's body parts to be inserted into a sheep when that's normally been the domain of Tory males.
Order, no.
Perhaps because we are a passionless people, things really get as exciting as they do in the Russian parliament, or indeed as athletic as they do in Africa. Thank God then for this man.
Most people gave them to their dogs, but I didn't. Say hello, Winston.
Winston oft appeared on the Holmes programme to explain his nocturnal activities.
So, Mr McGrath, Mr Peters arrives, what, about 1:30 in the morning, and an argument soon develops. How?
Well, the conversation got louder and louder, and they got closer and closer, louder and louder, closer and closer, until a little bit of pushing and shoving happened.
The trouble with Winston, though, is you go out with him, and it's like being with, you know, Princess Diana or something. There are just throngs of people all over the place, and they sort of want to know all about him, and they want to be with him, and they want, you know, they feel totally entitled to bowl up to him. He's one of those few politicians that, you know, he's like a rock star in that you don't talk about Winston Peters. You only need to talk about Winston.
But the rock star soon tired of these harmless barroom Barneys, and by 1997, he began quite literally to throw his weight around.
He reeked of booze. He was unsteady on his feet. And I said to him, I'm not interested in fighting you or any of your abuse, Mr. Peters. So just leave it, and walked on. And then I was grabbed.
Peters did something many of us would love to do. But he made the mistake of bashing Banksy in front of parliamentary party pooper and tetchy telltale Jim Anderton.
You've made it clear today, Mr. Anderton, that Mr. Peters had been drinking. What told you this?
Well, it was very clear that Mr. Peters had been drinking. You could actually smell the alcohol from yards away. Mr. Banks kept saying to Mr. Peters, you're drunk, Mr. Peters, take your hands off me, you're abusing me, Mr. Peters. Take your hands off me, I'm not going to be abused by a drunk.
Have you got a drinking problem?
Oh, Mr. Holmes, I've got no drinking problem, and you personally shouldn't be asking that question to me.
Of course, Winston has also been on the receiving end, as has Jim Anderton.
As he approached the crowd, he was given a warm welcome, but seconds later, he was showered with cake.
At least it was cake.
It's all right. Richard Preble got an egg in my elective the other night, so...
Indeed, Preble too had the smile wiped off his face. A reminder that when the public turns, politicians are easy prey, especially if they're foolish enough to go to Waitangi. But sometimes the politicians turn on the public. Sadly, there's no film of Muldoon laying into protesters in 1974. Though reports at the time say he landed some pretty useful punches.
That had a huge impact. It was massive news. He'd only been leader for a couple of weeks. And everyone who'd been hit complained to the police. And the police sort of, oh, we're lacking in witnesses, unfortunately. And they loved him, of course. But the interesting thing was what happened, the crossover. It destroyed Labor, that incident. The blokes across the country, traditional Labor voters, loved him for that. They were tired of these wankers.
By 1984, the anger was still there. But possibly, aware of the news cameras, he let this man off with a girly blow that barely touched his jumper.
That man struck me!
A native forest being destroyed!
There was more trouble when National's Jerry Brownlee threw his weight around while ejecting a tree-hugging, basket-weaving troublemaker via the stairs. Jerry was also there the day that Max Bradford attacked, applying a move he learned from Star Trek on a crusty student troublemaker.
A minister of the Crown dealing to a student protester.
But it's not just the Nats who attack. Recently, Trevor Mallard apologised to Parliament for punching out Tohinare. Interestingly, Mallard was involved in another fracas on these very steps in the 1980s. Angry miners had come to vent their spleen on the steps of Parliament. But this time, it wasn't Mallard losing his rag. It was Energy Minister and champion bun thrower Bob Tizard.
As he answered questions, television cameras rolled, photographers took pictures, and journalists took notes in what was a public meeting outside Parliament. But Mr. Tizard lost his temper with a radio reporter.
Just take it away. We're going to just take it away, will you? Get in there, girl. Get in there.
How do you think we feel?
I am concerned about these people. Take it away when you go.
Excuse me, sir.
Tizard had another tizzy during an interview with Lindsay Perigo.
Now, I'm not going to seek to explain it. I am perfectly prepared to explain the justification for the changes. Now, if you don't want that, I walk off the program.
But isn't it a fact that...
Do you want that or don't you? I am not going to go on arguing with you on a thing that I did not come here to discuss.
Mr. Tizard, your own Prime Minister has said that the way in which
good
this
afternoon.
Was...
The way in which this was done does not look good.
I am not going to discuss that with you. I made that clear.
But as we'll soon see, there's more to politics than violent outbursts and drunken shenanigans.
Okay, now section three. I'm going to show you a picture of a well-known politician, and I want you to choose a vegetable that you associate with this person.
In times past, we looked to our politicians to inspire us with their vision for a better future.
Feelings for the Green Party and annoyance.
We looked to them for direction and guidance. Today, the opposite is true. And it's through focus groups like this one that the politicians come to us for the answers.
Now that we're on the Green Party, I want you to tell me immediately what noise comes to mind when you think of the Green Party.
I'd say like a...
Today, politics is also the product of another hidden force, that of the image maker.
I think that Kirk, we've got to make an image of Kirk within a short period, within about 3 months.
Yeah, but Kirk,
everyone's got to understand Kirk.
When Bob Harvey was drafted in by Labor to give Norm Kirk a makeover, the hotshot mustachioed ad man invented the disease for which there is no cure.
You know, it's like selling a new motor car, I suppose, Mr. Kirk. We must make him a most viable and excellent commodity.
Before television, the campaign trail was a homely affair. Candidates attracted punters with ham off the bone, cheap jack advertising, and they parked up in caravans where they could lure in nubile male flesh. This man from Social Credit was reduced to talking to himself.
Were you too forceful about it? You mustn't be that. Close the gate carefully. Move on to the next house. Look to see that you can get an idea of the type of people from the approaches to it. Are there children around? Go to the sunny side of the house if it's a cold day, because people will listen better. Be friendly with them. Remember that friendliness is the thing that people need the most.
They were whistling in the dark. Bob Harvey saw the future, and it was packaged for a television audience.
His image has got to be, has got to come across strongly. Sure, what he's got to say on TV is very important, but his manner and his appearance. I said to Kirk, you know, that he's got to grow his hair longer.
He's had it
cut much too short, and he's got to wear more modern clothes than he's wearing, like shirts, for instance. I've said, you know, wear a coloured shirt more often. I think this is important.
From that day on, politicians were instructed how to walk, talk, and make nice to the camera. But you've got to have something to work with. Social Credit's media trainer didn't.
You've got to give some element of conviction.
Well, I think Louise came up very, very well. I think Colin is quite forceful, but I think myself, I'm very flat.
Oh, I don't think that. I think from a personality point of view.
What would you think is highlighted by this, which you've proved yourself?
Well, the thing that's highlighted to me is that I'm far too long-winded.
Rob Muldoon did his own media training.
In order to be natural, one has to make rather less movement and less extravagant gestures than one would in normal conversation. And indeed, as you notice, also talk a little more slowly and more deliberately. I think those come from the nature of the medium.
Direct he certainly was. He would bypass the interviewer and look straight down the barrel of the camera.
Do that along with my colleagues. The question of my death warrant won't worry me in the least.
Look at the camera and tell us why you did that.
Well, that was very deliberate, because I found that by doing this, you're looking straight into the eye of the person who's watching his television set, and he says, that fellow looks you in the eye, you know. Some fellow said to me, some fellow from TVNZ or whatever they called it in those days, you mustn't look down the barrel of the camera. That's bad. I did it all the more.
TV loved Muldoon, but it wasn't on good terms with Bill Rowling.
I don't like the artificiality of television. I make no pretense otherwise. Either television does not do me justice, I don't mean the people, but the mechanism, or I do not do myself justice in their eyes on television.
His difficulty both on television and elsewhere is that he has a very light voice. And he rarely sounds convincing because of it. It's an impediment, but something that he could do something about if he was of a mind to, but he doesn't.
Do you think he should, politically?
It's up to him. I'm not going to advise him on what he should do.
Soon, everyone submitted to media training. The perversion of image was masterminded by a vaguely satanic breed, who included David Beetson, Amanda Miller, and Brian Edwards. It led to weird before and after moments for Ruth Richardson and David Cagle, whose upper lip was scalped by a fast-talking Australian ad man.
We spent 2 days certainly convincing David that the moustache had to go.
Now, this is exactly the point that I've been making for a long time. The moustache, once again, because of the fact he parts his hair fairly wide in the middle, it really does tend to cut a line right across the face. The tendency to drop the eyebrows down and to lock in to a look of severity tends to alienate people.
Again, so, eeny, meeny, miny, moe, David's growth just had to go. Because, says McNamara, a moustache tends to deaden the skin under it. So he took a tape of the moleless minister across for a post-shave checkup.
The removal of the moustache, now keeping the eyes much more open so that people can get more access to where he's communicating. My God, a smile. Who could believe it? Politicians can smile.
Dr. Edwards' response was eloquent.
Bullshit. It really concerned me as well. I mean, there's a sort of moral issue involved here, where the man is saying, we should judge the future Prime Minister of this country or the contender to be the future Prime Minister on his eyebrows or his ability to change his smile or move his cheekbones up or down, whatever it may be. In other words, he's saying politics is a matter of cosmetics. And I think that's a tragic way to look at things.
Heir to Brian. In his role as Labour's media flunky, the Honourable Dr. Edwards went on to help make this look like this. It's said that there are two things you should never do. One, ask a gang member to make love to his mother. And two, mix politics and music.
Whilst the former invariably ends in tears, the latter has at least had some success.
A man of great labour is our big norm. A man of social credit is our big norm. A great national
today's politicians can only dream of the type of positive PR generated by Big Norm.
Big Norm.
A genuine hit song that celebrated the girth and greatness of Norman Kirk.
Norman's king of New Zealand, land of lambs, big fat lambs.
It was the work of two white guys from the Hut, who naturally went by the name of Ebony. This is Ebony member Don Wilson today.
Man yesterday, boy, you wanna see him now.
It won Wilson and Stefan Brown the 1974 Rata Award and garnered a telegram from the great man himself just hours before he died.
His message to the pop group Ebony was probably his last.
10 years later, Don Wilson had another crack at political pop smithery with Hey Mr. Longy.
Don't let the words you've spoken turn into promises that are broken. Were the speeches just a token? Were you for real or were you joking?
The song proved to be remarkably prescient, but like Longy's second term, it too sank like a stone.
There's a group in New York that sent me one of their records. They're called the Drongos. I think they're working on one too.
Political issues provided a more useful musical muse. Whether it be Herbs harmoniously haranguing us with their anti-nuke anthem French Letter, or Right, Left and Centre with their polite plea to wayward rugby players. Although racist tours and ecology proved inspirational,
we gotta stop it at any cost. Project Aqua's gotta go.
It was a song about tax that remains one of the finest of the genre.
Nobody gives a toss pot.
Ah, come on.
About the inflation rate.
Oh, I wouldn't say that.
And nobody's buying a record drop. It's just sales tax we all hate. So don't give me culture. I'm not hearing you wrong. I could buzz around like a beehive boy, but I'd like to see you do my job.
Up front with the norms.
For all its flaws, and despite our complete distrust of its practitioners, there's no doubt that without the government and its lumbering apparatus, we would feel as bereft as an amputee who, missing a limb, would scratch in vain at the gangrenous appendage that once threatened his very existence.
In this, our Aotearoa, land of politics.
The big man.